So Bleach episode 9, was it good? Was it bad? Did I have any complaints? Did I have any nitpicks this time? To answer that question, no I don't. So you can rejoice and finally stop complaining about my little nitpicks. Other than that, let's get into the review, shall we? This episode in general was very surprising to me. I expected the last 2 minutes to 1 minute really just being the kind of introduction of Unohana vs Kenpachi, as I expected the majority of episode 10 to be that fight in particular. Though, however, those things have kind of changed now, and for good reason. This episode, in fact, did cover about 4 and maybe a smidgen bit more than 4 chapters, but definitely not 5 because I am removing most of the Nimaya stuff, which is a large portion of those chapters. So I'm going to say, you know, give it a roundabout of 4 chapters, which felt pretty much like 4 chapters. There was 2 parts of this episode, which was Ichigo and Renji eating and then Kenpachi versus Unohana. And it was just great to see both those parts of the episodes. And that's specifically why I thought Unohana versus Kenpachi was going to be the last minute, because I thought we're going to have all of this Nimaya type of comedy and introduction, which would seem to me that maybe that this is going to be pushed into episode 10, and we'll talk about that in the spoilers video maybe tomorrow, because that's when it comes out on the website. But let's see if my prediction comes true on the first half being Kenpachi versus Unohana and the second part being Nimaya Uetsu, and then we might get into everything but the rain in the last 3 episodes, because it is confirmed 13 episodes this season because of the Blu-ray box set telling us that it is, even though it was kind of confirmed beforehand anyway. But it doesn't matter, we have a concrete number now. Before I get into this, I will say, just like I said in my live reaction as well, is that the title cards for these episodes are containing extra information. So of course, when I was talking about Ikaku and Renji and their broken Bankai's not being explained in episode 8, well, the answer to that was it's because it was explained within the title cards, which, you know, thankfully they are all on the website, so you can use Google Translate and you can have a nice read of them. Yeah, it's a bit of broken English, but it does actually tell you at least 90% of what it needs to say, and you can pretty much understand it pretty well. That being said, taking out Ikaku and Renji for that scene wasn't particularly bad, and to have it in the title card was good as well. And we get some really cool information in regards to this episode as well, because one of the things that I was kind of having a little bit of a teeny weeny tangent over, like it's a very smidgen, was I was talking about how the towel on Ichigo's head wasn't being told by Kurenji, because if you don't keep the towel on your head, then you're kind of disbalancing the spiritual pressure that's being recovered, and then it can just like explode out of his head or whatever that really means. But then again, considering how we saw Kurenji's little servants and they had to wear their armor and seeing their skin kind of burn to some extent or have little cuts on their body, maybe it explains to me that the spiritual energy was kind of like puncturing through maybe their muscles and maybe their skin, is my kind of visual idea of how this spiritual pressure is just going to erupt from someone's head. You know, your stereotypical mind-blown gif. That being said though, throughout episode 8 and episode 9, Ichigo did have his towel on his head on and off in multiple sequences. So sometimes I thought it was inconsistencies, but you know, that could have just been general banter between Kurenji and Ichigo. That really wasn't put into the anime because, you know, it's kind of pointless and kind of ruins away a little bit of the tone slightly. So with that being said, I am extremely grateful that it was mentioned within the title card itself, explaining that kind of ideology and also bringing back a little bit of Kisuke and Yodowichi about how they have also a healing spa as well, or bath or spring or whatever you want to call it, because of course we didn't get that reference in the episode either. So you know, if they're gonna throw it in these title cards, I think it is very informative. It gives you a reason to stick around and actually get involved and invested, so I've got no issues with it whatsoever in the slightest. Yeah, of course we'd all love to see that interaction, but you know, it's not really something that we were all itching and waiting to see. It's just nice little tidbits here and there that really give a bit of life and soul, unironically, into the world of Bleach. So of course Ichigo is finally healed. There is a punching shot with Kurenji. Kurenji's like, yeah, you're healed, good to go. Then Renji's like, yo, I'm good too. Gives him a nice uppercut to the ribcage. Renji's like, ugh, I got this, bro. And they go off on their merry way to Hikifune's place. Now I will say, there is 2 slight little nitpicks, which I kind of do want to just get off my chest. You know, it doesn't mean really much of anything. And this is because maybe Mob Psycho or even Chainsaw Man have kind of, you know, spoiled me a little bit in terms of animation. But when Ichigo got hit by Kurenji in the face, it was kind of just like a still shot with some like speed lines and a little bit of, you know, camera movement effect. and I would have just actually liked to have seen the punch in motion, kind of conveying speed and, you know, maybe a little bit of a glimpse of like Ichigo kind of, you know, reflecting back a little bit. Maybe again, that's something I would have just liked, hey, canonly, but I don't know. I just thought a still was a bit less impactful than it really could have been. And I guess the same a little bit with Renji. However, I did like that, like he was clenching his fist, showing that he was holding back a bit of pain, that it did really hurt him. But again, that punch, Kurinji is a character that I really liked, so to have him convey any type of power would have been just really nice for me personally. You know, that's my little nitpick. Okay, we can move on. Then we get to Hikifune, but before that, they are saved by the gracious King of New York himself, and that is Khan, because Khan is introduced into this episode after we saw him briefly in episode 8. And what about him? Well, let's just say something that has been taken from us has been given to us. And that is the man, the mystery of Buff Khan. Muscle Man Buff Khan. And honestly, we love to see it. There's not really much more to say than that. It's a meme, you know. It's just Khan. He's buff. We always love to see Khan. So in regards to talking about Hikifune, obviously we know about her techniques, is that she can cook. She puts her spiritual energy into that food and makes her extremely skinny. Well, not extremely skinny, but in comparison to the weight loss, it would be considered extremely skinny. Again, I have to commemorate the animators for doing their thing with the jiggle. That being said, I definitely have a new appreciation for Hikifune. I do feel the face is a bit interesting, because again, I do believe it might get slightly adjusted in the Blu-ray. It's just a hunch, but when I was looking at the manga in comparison to the anime, I was like, yeah, that face, it's not a bad piece of art at all. Like, Hikifune looks absolutely great. It's just there is a difference and I can't put my tongue on it. I think it is maybe the eye tattoos, I'm not quite sure, but there is something a bit interesting or a bit off about that face. But either way, we love Hikifune. It looked great, or her model looked great in general. But yeah, I mean, most of this conversation is just Ichigo and Renji just eating all these monstrous amounts of food. Of course, Khan as well. Don't know how Khan can eat, but he do be eating, whether that food is just made out of spiritual energy and it's actually spiritual energy that they're eating rather than an actual substance of diet and nutrients and food and solid. Again, we're just overthinking something that just shouldn't be overthought, because in that case, Khan would have probably benefited, but at the same time, I highly doubt it, because teddy bears can't fucking eat. That being said though, a lot of this conversation was actually just like, this is what you're here to do. You're actually here to genuinely eat and to recover and to rest, because in order to get ready for the next training session and in order to get ready for the next battle, you need to let your body rest and heal, which is nice to reiterate, because sometimes in the shonen battle mangas or the shonen animes, you can sometimes expect characters to just go fight after fight after fight with no sleep or no rest, and sometimes it can be a bit unrealistic to that degree. So I love that there is a basis of a little bit of realism in this regard. And of course, a nice little touch as well for those that obviously haven't been paying attention, Ichigo's his Bankai, his Shihakusho, his outfit is part of his Bankai, because that Bankai is broken. You're obviously not going to see that repaired. Like, his sleeve is still gone, his buttons and his straps, I guess you could say, are still broken. Even though his spiritual pressure is good, even though his body is healed, Shihakusho is still tattered, because it's just not going to heal, because the Bankai is in fact broken. It's little details like that I do generally appreciate. And then of course we get our introduction to Nimaya Uetsu, to which I hope we get to see his harem next episode. Obviously that's not the biggest part of next episode. It's obviously Kenpachi versus Unohana, which we're going to be getting into now, because this was a great fight overall, because again, I didn't expect it to go on for as long as I did. It went on for about 5-ish minutes. There was a good amount of drama in there. I didn't expect to see young Kenpachi in the manga. They're just showing his eye, but in the anime, we got a nice full facial shot. Same with Unohana. The POV perspectives, I love the POV perspectives in Bleach. They are going really hard. Granted, they were still shots. I would have loved to see more, but again, we've been kind of teased with that episode 7, the original Gotei 13. So hopefully next episode, those little teases come to fruition and we get some really cool back in the past type of fight, which I think, let's be honest, everybody wants to see how that fight went down. Everybody wants to see Kenpachi slaughter a bunch of people, which I generally think we can get after episode 7 with the original Gotei. I genuinely believe we can actually get that. So Kenpachi just massacring a bunch of dudes, Unohana comes out of nowhere, clapped his cheeks and then called it a day. But yeah, it was kind of nice to know that. It was kind of cool to understand the meaning between Yachiru's name as well, the 8,000 styles, I believe. Hopefully I don't mess that up. And of course, having her name is Yachiru, which is someone that Kenpachi admires, and someone that he called Yachiru, being the pink girl. Yachiru his lieutenant. It's all fitting together, isn't it, boys? It's all convulging. So I would love and hope that we get more info in regards to that as well. And that's kind of the reason why I haven't done a Kenpachi specific video in regards to that, because I'm hoping the anime can really set it in stone. But I hope we get that. I hope we get the pass, and I hope we get the conclusion of this fight. Of course, this episode does show the start of this fight. And again, as I said, I was surprised because the animation was really good, actually. Like, for what it was, the Muken is surprising because obviously the Muken is an infinite space. Now, of course, we get to see pillars, we get to see light. Obviously, the light is from the door from behind, so they're reflecting off these crystal things. They show in light, and I think that that was a smart decision because these things didn't exist in the manga, if I'm remembering correctly. It's a good excuse to kind of portray light in that sort of aspect so we can actually see what's going on, because, technically, we wouldn't be able to see them fighting in just pitch blackness. Yeah, but yeah, I do believe that that is the entranceway of the Muken, and the further you go down is there's nothing there. So I would imagine no pillars, no nothing. Imagine like the hyperbolic time chamber, right, where you have that little platform and then after that it's gone. So I believe they're fighting in the entranceway, which is my headcanon or my cope for not knowing how the Muken works. So yeah, I do wonder if they do have like a little sort of a map in general though of like the Muken, because they put a lot of prisoners down in the Muken, don't they? So surely they've got to have like a little map or coordinates of like walk forward 100 steps and then turn left 100 steps and you'll get to Aizen, or and then they've like planted little lights in the ground so they can shine. But then you've got to make electricity, so if they wired electricity through like the ground of infinite space. I'm thinking way too much of this, right? There's lots of criminals in the Muken is basically what I'm saying, and they're probably mapped out on like a scroll or something of like directions. Thinking way too much into this. Fight was good though. I really enjoyed it. It really hit. We get to see Kenpachi fumble a lot because to Unohana, and I was rewatching this episode and I was listening clearly to the voice acting. I was listening really carefully to the words that were being used, and you could tell in comparison to any fight that we'd seen of Kenpachi, this one was limiting him more than maybe even Noritora, Ichigo. You know, he put those limiters on his head, like those bells and, you know, the choker for his eye patch. And even giving Ichigo the first hit, for example. These limiters are things that Kenpachi does to get a thrill from battle. And I noticed as well that when Kenpachi is fighting Unohana, he's getting emotional. This, just seeing Unohana and seeing, like, he mentions about his scar aching. Obviously, Yachiru's talking about her scar aching as well. But you can really see that this is bothering him. Like, him confronting Yachiru is bothering him, and he wants to win this so much that he's mentally restricting himself even more than ever, I'd argue, you know? With Kenpachi, with Noritora, he was just having fun. He was just like, how many hits can I take before I can finish this guy type of thing? With Yachiru right now, like, he's throwing some hits, eye patch off, and he's still weak in comparison. And you can see that this is bothering him because obviously we're less than like a few minutes in and he's already crying. Kenpachi doesn't cry, but you can understand that he's just had his sword being ripped away from him, and he's looking at Yachiru and he's crying and he's being like, I admired you and all these tricks that you're using, like, I'm disappointed. To which, you know, she's saying, no, you're weak. You never gave me a chance to use these tricks earlier. These little sly little blades flying from the air. If you play BBS, you know, you would know that reference. So Kenpachi is extremely disappointed with himself, and she managed to crack him. Within 2 minutes of fighting, she managed to crack him. I will say choreography was always nice to see. I would say martial arts, but maybe that's maybe insulting. Maybe I wouldn't so much say martial arts, but some hand-to-hand combat. It was cool to see Unohana, or Yachiru. I'm just going to say whichever. Hopefully you get what I mean. It was really cool to see Unohana actually use her feet and her arms to actually block moves of Kenpachi, maneuver around quickly, taking some shots. But I was equally impressed to see Kenpachi also get a few kicks in there too, which I wasn't expecting. However, you know, she was right. You're still using one hand after all this time, and you're not using the other hand to do absolutely anything. What are you doing? You're not taking this battle seriously. I can't imagine you're enjoying it. And the point of this fight is to break Kenpachi in the sense, like, you're breaking him down to build him like 10 times up. And that's because apparently that every time that Kenpachi, you know, faces some kind of near-death experience, he gets stronger. And this is because of Unohana's sin, which is the sin of being the last person to give Kenpachi a good fight. So she has to take responsibility for getting Kenpachi to back to his potential, back to his strongest, I guess, state of mind or body, for that example. And then after you've gotten him to that point, then have a clash of blows and then see who's the best. And then of course some of us know what the outcome is, but it is interesting and you're going to get to see more of that development through next episode. So I really hope they nail on the head for that in regards. And then to top it all off as well, there is a little bit of interesting, I guess, hints here and there. Again, a bit of an issue that people had with this fight to some degree is, one, what does, we'll ask that question next episode, what does it do? And also, when Kenpachi was getting hit and sliced and diced up and getting his neck stabbed, why was he coming back alive? Was he losing consciousness? What was in fact going on? The interesting hint here, and I do think it is purposeful to do this, is once Unohana stabbed Kenpachi in the neck, you see him spit out blood and that blood goes on Unohana's face. Of course, on Unohana's face, it is still, that blood is still there when Kenpachi, quote unquote, wakes up, which tells us that obviously this action did in fact happen, and chances are that Unohana, with her mastery of healing, actually was able to instantaneously heal him like that. However, the only issue I have, especially in the manga and in the anime, is did Unohana, like, once he was passed out, go back, grab his sword, pick it up, go put it back in his hand, heal him for when, and then get back into position the moment he wakes up? It's a bit, I'm not fully convinced. I just find it a little bit funny, and I, you know, it's not a problem, it's just making a joke out of a weird situation. But yeah, it did happen, and I believe it was Unohana's healing techniques, which is, if it's instantaneous like that, that's got to be pretty cracked. But again, all of these questions I'm having in my head are regards to next episode and how it's portrayed, and again, a lot of explanation on regards to Shikai, Bankai, all that sort of stuff. I'm fascinated, to say the least. I did enjoy this episode a lot. I know that maybe this review has been a bit of a tangent, but, you know, these are things that I just wanted to kind of talk about in regards. Kyoroku being new head captain, expected. Not really surprising for me as a manga reader, unfortunately, but it makes sense. And Central 46 is still one of the worst governments potentially in anime history, I'm not quite sure. To be given such a high seat of authority, they're a bit brain dead and a bit incapable of doing their job correctly. Maybe Yuha should have gone after them first. Well, Aizen did, so he was smart about it, but I think I'm gonna leave it off at that. Tell me your guys' thoughts, of course, in the comment section down below, of what you liked about this episode and anything new that you found out in between this. With that being said though, I'm gonna catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day, JaymesHanson, and as always, people, peace out.